And I'm going to try not to blubber and slobber and try to save that for a little bit later. If I do get emotional, then y'all just going to have to bear with it because I'm here and you're not. So somebody asked me yesterday if it was different because it's somebody from my house graduating. And that's a little bit of it, but that's not even the biggest part of it, honestly. These kids who were here, when we started attending this church 8 years ago, Kayla and Matthew were fourth graders when we started bringing Valerie along. And then when I got to start working with the youth, just as a member of the church, the ones who were here who were involved were just finishing up their sixth grade year going into seventh grade. And then when I got to be in the position I'm in now, some of them who were here were in their eighth grade year, getting ready to finish up at their middle schools. So this group is a larger group. They've been a more active group, but they've been a group that's been with me since my beginning here. And so that's what's the emotional part to me. I go to graduations a lot. You know, I've seen a bunch of those. But it's just different when you know things are going to change and the ones you have counted on and have enjoyed are going to be transitioning into a different role. So if I get upset, that's what I am emotional about. And so now you know. Each one of them, we are going at our lunch today. We are having lunch for them and their families. It's not going to cost anything. It's free, too. Each grad will get a monogrammed beach towel. It's also got your initials on it. This is the girls' towel. And this is the guys' towel. If you cannot stay for lunch, come and see me, and we'll give you your gift bag to take with you. But that's a gesture from our youth committee to them as a thank you and a congratulations. As I call your name, just want you to each stand up so they can see you again, looking all nice and pretty and handsome. Miss Kendra Crocker is on the – turn around and face them, Kendra. Can you handle this, Ashley? Ashley Edmonds. I want y'all to see what Ashley is wearing. This is perfect. This is the Ashley I know and love. Casey Evans. Casey, you're actually getting a comforter. It's the same size, but you can use it for a comforter. Matthew Grubb. Matthew did not get the wardrobe memo, apparently. Caitlin Heath. Sean McGovern. This is another one that has some attitude this morning. Lance Phillips. Kayla Starling. And Valerie Stewart. When we eat lunch, and after, I do have some things I will say to each of you briefly, and that's when I will probably cry. But we've got a slideshow, and each graduate every year, I try to pick a song out for them that is special in some way. Sometimes it might be a song they like. Sometimes it might be a connection we've got. Sometimes I might just think it's appropriate, and I made the slideshow, so I can do that. There's going to be a couple of songs that are going to be a little bit harder and faster than you're used to hearing at KNBC, and you're going to be thinking, what in the world is that racket? It is Christian rock music. So there's some other Christian songs. There's some country songs that are probably familiar, but the songs you've never heard of, those are Christian songs, because this slideshow is for them. It's not for us, for you, it's for them. So this is one of my little gifts to y'all, so I hope you enjoy it. If you don't tell me. that'll make me cry too.
Promise me that you'll give faith a fighting chance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you dance. I hope you dance. I hope you never fear those mountains in the distance. Never settle.
We won't hesitate to break down the garden gate. There's not much time left today.
Stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to. I want to again extend our congratulations to the graduates. And we've got a few words in the sermon today for the church as a whole, but also for you graduates. I think things that would help you in your life and in the days to come, and one of those things is to be a unifier, to help unify, to help build consensus and harmony, not to gossip, to be an encourager and encourage one another, to lift people up and to edify. And to let you know, to me, and I know this to be true, but it's very true to me, is that the church is the most awesome organization that you can ever be a part of to make an impact on society. I have seen through the church, through the members of the church, seeing people come to know Christ. I've seen people set free from burdens in life. I've seen marriages restored. I've seen families reunited. I've seen people conquer addictions. I've seen people find true joy, true love, true peace, not in the things that this world offers, but in something that only God can offer you. And I encourage you to be involved in the Church of Jesus Christ. I'm not talking about just a building or an organization or a lot of programs. I'm talking about getting together and joining in and becoming a unifier in the body of Christ, because lives are blessed when people come to know the Lord. That doesn't mean that the church always gets it right. And so often we do not reach our potential as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. God desires that all Christians get along, and that the body of Christ comes together and that it's unified. And when the body of Christ is unified and it is working together, it can change the world. It did so in the first centuries of this era of time, the year of our Lord, or it's called today the common era. Society was changed. The Roman Empire had all kinds of terrible behavior, all kinds of immorality, all kinds of inhumanity to other human beings. And the church came on the scene, and within 400 to 500 years, that all changed. New laws were written, and those laws were more kind to infants and to children and to women and to human beings. And eventually, the world was changed by Christianity. And it can still happen again, and our country needs to get back to the founding principles. Our country was founded on the principles that God is the creator of heaven and earth, that Jesus Christ is God's only Son, and only through him do we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. And it was founded on the Bible as God's holy word. And what we need to do as Christians, and what you need to do in society today, is be a unifier, be an answer. Don't be a problem, be an answer. Be a way to help make a solution for the problem. Jesus was emphatic about the church being together and being unified. And he says that in the Word of God, he will bring all the resources of heaven to bear to help the church do that. I don't know why we can't do that better than we do. To be a unifier, though, you need to be a lover. In our society today, that even has some bad connotations. But I mean, you need to be a lover of Jesus Christ, and you need to be a lover of people. That's what God commands us to do. In John chapter 13, verse 35, he says, "By this all will know," Jesus says this, "that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Did you get that? That's the key ingredient, that we need to love one another. He says, if you're going to be called by my name, you need to love one another, and people need to know that you love one another. And I asked the question this morning, how do you think we as a church are doing? Do people look at us, look at our church, and think that's a church that's built on love? Those people really love one another. Or do they look at you in your individual life and ask the question, do you really love people? Do they know you love people? Do they know you willingly sacrifice for the needs of others? Or are you a gossiper? Are you one who talks down about people? Are you an encourager? Are you one that helps bring a solution to the problem? Do they know us by our love? Paul in the book of Ephesians chapter 3 says, "I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, did not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers." Paul had a lot to say in this book of Ephesians and through his other epistles about unity, about being together. He says that he gives thanks and he makes prayers for these people because they have faith in Jesus Christ and they love all the saints. And I want to tell you this morning, lots of times I get on people in the church and you know, I'm stepping on toes. And last week it was really a toe-stepping Sunday for a lot of people. But I step on my own toes. But I want to tell you that Kinley Missionary Baptist Church is a church I love. And I love you. I don't love you as I should. I don't love the Lord as I should. But I love the people in this church. And I love this church. We don't have a lot of sects or groups in this church as far as I'm concerned. And everybody seeks to try to love one another as best they can. We hold the Bible in high esteem in this church. We believe it is God's word and we seek to love one another. I don't know of any sects or groups in our church that run around and gossip all the time. But this message is for all of us this morning because we could be so much better at unifying and loving one another. And I want us to do that in the days ahead. I've seen people in this church yield and submit their own desires for those of desires of others. I've seen people in this church get hurt and get their feelings hurt and still not hold a grudge and still participate and find it in their hearts the ability to forgive. And that is awesome. I told First Church this morning that there are a lot of churches in this town, in this community, and I know some of you go to some of those churches, and I hope you feel the same way about your church that I feel about this church. But I've been and visited several churches, and I know a lot of the pastors, and I know a lot of the people in those churches. And I would love to go to those churches and visit and participate and be a part of it. But this is my church. This is the church I want to belong to because I love the people here. And I just want you all to know that this morning because I'm getting ready to step on your toes. Did you pick up on what Paul said there, why he was so thankful for this church and made mention of them in his prayers? He said, I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints. Paul was thankful for their faith in Jesus Christ and for their love for all the saints. The word saints just means sanctified ones or holy ones. We're made holy by Jesus Christ. When you ask him into your heart and you begin to believe in him and trust in him, then he sends the Holy Spirit and he unifies you in the Holy Spirit and he gives us his love and he gives us his righteousness and we're made holy in his eyes. And if you are a Christian, then you want to be holy. You want to do better. You want to try to please and serve your Lord Jesus Christ. But I love what Paul says here. The people had faith. And the people loved one another. And that's what excited him. And that's what excites me about this church. Yesterday, I hope when you leave, if you didn't see him when you came in this morning, we planted 125 little juniper bushes out there in the front of that bank so we won't have to cut the grass anymore. And we were hoping that'll just take over and spread all over. But I had about 15, 20 people here yesterday helping do. And I had the best time yesterday. We worked and we had a great time. Just camaraderie. Kidding, having a good time of fellowship. Out there working ourselves to the bone. Some of us hadn't worked that hard in a long time manually, and many of us were giving out. But I loved it because I was with people I love to be with, and I enjoy being with, and people who take me as I am. And that's what's about the church is all about, and I believe this church is about that. But I want us to do even better at that. God demands that we be a unifying presence in the church. He doesn't just think it's a good idea. God demands it. He commands that we be like that. I've seen a lot of teams in sports who just had average talent sometimes beat a team with greater talent than they had because they were unified. I used to love to watch the Boston Celtics. This is back before most everybody's day in here when they had John Havlicek and Bob Cousy and Bill Russell. I used to love them. See them play because they would play together as a cohesive unit and they would offense, defense, whatever, they just played together and I enjoyed that and because they were unified, because they sought to do it together as a team. And when we don't work together as a church, folks, we're going to be a lot weaker. You know, it's essential for you to come to church on Sunday morning. I know that today in our society there are a lot of things going on and people are busy doing a lot of different things. But you are missed when you don't come to church. You are missed. Oh, we might not get on the phone and ask you where you were last Sunday, because usually when you do that, people start thinking, well, we're butting into their business, and why are you asking me, and you're getting on my case. I love it when we have a lot of people here. It's just more exciting. It's more people in the choir. It's more exciting. I'm on the praise team in the first service. It's great. And maybe I don't call you up every day you miss. I don't want you to think I'm nagging you. But I miss your being here. And I want you to be here. There's more fun when we have everybody involved and together. So Paul puts it this way in Ephesians chapter 4. He says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness, gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing one another in love. Paul was a prisoner, actually, when he wrote this. He was in prison. And he writes this letter, and he's talking about this congregation of people in this town called Ephesus. And he's talking about how he loves them and he misses them. And he says, you've been called to a calling. That calling is basically this. This is another thing I love about the church. It's very simple. Love God with all your heart. Love your neighbor like you love yourself. And then go spread the good news of Jesus Christ to all the world, that he loved you enough to die on a cross for your sins. And you can have eternal life, and you can have joy now in this life, and you can experience abundant life now if you know Jesus Christ. It's just that simple. You don't have to work for it or earn it. It's a gift that he gives to you. He says, that's your calling. And when you're called, you got to walk worthy of that calling. And the way you walk worthy of that calling is you do it in lowliness and gentleness, and you long suffer and you bear with one another. Now, sometimes in the church, sometimes outside the church, we have a hard time doing that. This means you got to swallow your pride. You can't think you're better than other people. And we all do that at one time or another. We see somebody on the street and we say, I'm glad I'm not like that person. You know, we even look at people in our family sometimes and think that we're better. But we're to love one another. We're to long suffer with one another. And why do we do that? Because Jesus did that for us. But the underlying foundation of the church is found here, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. God has given us his Holy Spirit. I asked first service this morning, do you know that you're Spirit-filled? Do you know that the Spirit of God lives in you? If you're a Christian, I believe this, when you become a Christian, the Spirit of God comes to live in your life. But do you know you have the Spirit? And I'm not talking about speaking in tongues. I'm not talking about shouting or jumping, and all those things are fine. I don't have anything against any of those things. But do you know the Spirit of God dwells in you? Last Wednesday night, we had a prayer meeting, Bible study in here, and we were talking about all this stuff, and one of these ladies that blessed me, just blessed me to know, and she says, I know I got the Spirit. She says, I don't speak in tongues, and my sisters all speak in tongues, and they tell me I don't have the Spirit, but I know I got the Spirit. Because Jesus lives in me, and he changed me, and I'm happier. I'm more at peace. She says, I got it. And if you're a Christian, you should have it. Now, that doesn't mean you're on cloud nine all the time, and you're running around dancing and prancing, but it means you have a peace, a joy, a love. You know God's there. It's not just a feeling. It's a knowing. It's a knowing. I know that God resides in my heart because when I pick up his words sometimes, even when I don't want to study, even when I don't want to get up early to read the Bible and I start getting into his word, all of a sudden the Spirit of God starts working with my spirit, and all of a sudden I'm going, yes, that's right, that's awesome, that's God, that's good. You know, have you got the Spirit? And you need the Spirit so that we can be unified. He says, above all else, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us together in perfect harmony. Above all, he says, whatever you do, clothe yourself. How do you clothe yourself in harmony or in love? How do you clothe yourself? Well, the Bible, some translations say put on love. It's like this. To me, God is sitting right here offering us love. And all we need to do is receive it and just wrap it around us and wrap ourselves up in it and just love God and seek. How do you love anything? You know, you make an effort to do it. You make a commitment to do it. And I'm telling you, if you will make an effort to love God, then you'll have unity and perfect peace. So the first thing we need to do if we want to be unifiers is to love. So you guys need to go out and love people. As hard as it is sometimes. And you guys need to love people too. And keep on doing it. Second thing that we need not to do is gossip. This is the way we disrespect people. It's the way we disrupt unity. And we fail to show love. Gossip is bad, and it will destroy unity in the church. Few things can destroy unity in the church more than gossip can. Well-known Christian organization has in its employee policy manual that if you gossip, they'll fire you. And I believe that's a good policy, because gossip will tend to destroy an organization. It will bring it down. If you have a problem with somebody or you suspect somebody's doing something wrong, go to that person and tell them. Don't talk about it. Don't jump and speculate and start talking about people. It can ruin people. There was a man one time, I'm told, there was a story, who was convicted that he was a gossip. And so he went to a priest and he said, I'm convicted. I'm no longer going to gossip. To the best of my ability, I will gossip no more. But he says, I feel bad about all the gossiping I've done and the hurt it's caused people, and I want to rectify that somehow. How can I make amends and make that right? And the old priest said, go get you a feather pillow. Y'all don't know what a feather pillow is. It's got feathers in it, not foam. Go get you a feather pillow, take it up to the mountain tomorrow morning and rip that thing open and let the feathers fly everywhere. Dutifully, the guy went up the next morning and opened the feather pillow, and the feathers went everywhere. The next day, he goes back down to the priest. He says, well, I did what you did. You told me to do. Now what? He says, go back and pick up every feather. The guy said, that's impossible. He said, you get the point. Those feathers went everywhere. And those words you say go everywhere. And you don't even know where they go. They go farther than you ever realize, because somebody picks it up and takes it somewhere else, and there's no way you can get it back. So the best thing we can do is not gossip. Do not gossip. In Romans chapter 1, Paul gives us a list of some pretty bad things. And in the midst of those things, it talks about gossiping. It says, they were all filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They were full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful. Gossip is literally whisper. You know, and usually when we gossip, we're kind of whispering. Did you hear about so-and-so? Do you know where I saw their car? Do you know what I saw? And lots of times it's just speculation. You saw something and it looked like something, and maybe it wasn't even that, but you spread the rumor. And it caused all kinds of pain. A slanderer is really a backbiter. It's somebody that really wants to get you. But a gossiper is somebody that takes unproven information and starts to expand upon it. Private information about others. You know, again, if you've got a problem, you need to go to the person. You don't need to go to somebody else and talk about it. James cautions us this way. The tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole person and sets the whole course of life on fire. And it itself is itself set on fire by hell. I set a fire as a little child one time, playing with matches. I was probably 10 or 11, I don't know. And all of a sudden, the grass was kind of dry. And then before I knew it, it had spread. And I thought it was going to burn down the whole neighborhood, you know. And fortunately, there was a hose nearby, and I went and got it. But I had burned a space probably 15, 20 feet in diameter, you know, just like that. And that's how easy it is for the tongue to ruin other people. You know, if you've got any question whether it's gossip or not, don't say it. That's hard. All of us got a little bit of that in us. I wouldn't make you turn to one another and say, we all got a little gossip in us, but I'm not going to do it. But you got it, and I've got it. We need to stop it. We don't need to do it. Another story I heard, this lady named Harriet, the church gossip. She was wicked, boy. She just loved to gossip, loved to talk about other people and put them down. And everybody in the church was a little afraid of her, but one day she messed up. This new fella, not me, but a guy named George came to the church. And he parked his car out in front of the liquor store, and it stayed there all day. And Harriet started spreading rumors that he was an alcoholic. She told it all around town. Finally, it got back to George. George saw her in the hall one day. She went up to him. She said, "Your car was parked in front of the liquor store all day long. You must be an alcoholic." George was a man of few words. He didn't say anything, except he drove his car that night, that afternoon, over to Harriet's house. And he parked it in front of Harriet's house, and he left it there all night. You know, if you see my car at the liquor store all day long, it's one of two things, or maybe several others. It's there for a reason. Well, it's there for a reason, whatever it is. Either I got a problem with alcohol, or it's there for some other reason. But you need to find out what the reason is before you start telling the preacher is an alcoholic. You know, it might have broken down. I might have been in there witnessing to somebody. Talk to the person that did it. Don't start talking about it. Go to them. Go to your brother and ask. Don't tolerate gossip and don't be a source of gossip. That's good for everybody in here. Don't tolerate. If somebody's doing it in as nice a way as you can, say, you know, I just don't want to participate in this. This could harm somebody. This could hurt somebody. Do you know this to be the truth? You know, and you don't need to spread it unless you know, and you don't even need to say it then. If it's not building somebody up or edifying, and if you've got a problem or you think this person's got a problem, go to them and try to get it worked out. And then don't be a source of gossip. And if anyone's gossiping, you know, just try to get it straightened out. And you, first of all, do not be a source of gossip. You know, and if a few people would do that, when somebody starts gossiping, after a while, that gossip would stop. Peter, I love what Peter says. He says, "The one who wants to love life and to see good days must keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit." Do you want to love life? Would y'all like to love life? Would you like to have good days? Well, this is a prescription for it. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Don't be a gossip. Be a unifier. There's one other element I want to talk about. We need to love one another, and we don't need to talk about one another. And then we need to forgive one another. Forgiveness is essential to the unity of your church. If you have unforgiveness in your heart, your walk with God is going to be hindered. Your prayer life, your worship life, your intimate relationship, his effectual working in your life. If you have unforgiveness in your life, if you can't forgive other people, then you're not going to have as intimate, as close a relationship with God. When you do that, you need to forgive one another. If Jesus died and suffered on the cross, if he was beaten beyond recognition, if he cried in sorrow the night before he was crucified and was in such suffering and pain, and he did it all for you and me, he died on that cross, and he didn't sit there and say, "Well, that person's got this problem and this problem, and I just can't die for them, and I could never forgive them." No, he died. He who was innocent, who was perfect without sin, died for you and me. And yet we would hold forgiveness from somebody else? We have no right to do it. And we get hurt sometimes by people. Yeah, I mean, you can really get hurt, but you cannot hold on to that forgiveness. It's only going to give you an ulcer, not somebody else. You got to forgive people. And realize this, if you're a person of faith, my book says, "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord." And God will repay one day. I don't need to worry about it. I don't need to repay. God will repay. And I need to forgive. And if you've got unforgiveness in your heart today, I'm telling you, you need to get rid of it. And you can't be in unity with God. You can't be in unity with your family. And you surely can't be in unity with the church if there's unforgiveness in your heart. Now, I'm not saying it goes like this, and you might be wrestling with it right now, but you need to get rid of it. You need to give it to God. Jesus said, "I came to bear all your burdens. Cast them on me." Well, that's one of them we need to give up. Begin to forgive. Jesus says, "If you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins." There's too much unforgiveness in the church and too much animosity, and it's directed sometimes to the staff or to other members or to the choir director or the piano player or whoever, the praise team band. And those people don't even know about it. They haven't got a clue. And you're worrying yourself to death, and you can't sleep at night, and you're all upset, and you can't eat your food, and you got indigestion. Forgive them. Forgive them. The last verse, you must clothe yourselves with tender-hearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowances for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. You know why we don't forgive one another? Pride. It's ego. It's, well, you don't know what they did to me. They really hurt. Yeah. But it's not going to do you any good to get a lot of angst over it. Jesus died for your sins. Jesus died for their sins. Jesus died for every sin. One day Jesus is coming back. And when he comes back, he's going to make all things right. He's going to take care of every grievance you have. If you've got unforgiveness in your heart, he says, I'm not going to forgive you. So let's get busy forgiving and reconciling. Jesus says this in Matthew chapter 6. I say to you, love your enemies. Boy, you're talking about, you want to be a Christian? This is what it's about. It's the best life you can ever live, but this is what it's about. Love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. Wow. And you know why he does do that, he says? That you may be sons of God your Father. In heaven. I don't know about you, but I want to do better. I want to be a unifying church member. I don't want to talk about people. I want to forgive people, and I want to love people, and I need God's help doing that. And the neat thing about Christianity is when you ask Jesus into your heart, he will love you, and he will forgive you, and he'll give you the strength and the power and the love and the forgiveness to do all of this stuff if you'll just let him. There's a pledge in your bulletins this morning. I'm going to give you time to look at that if you got one. If you don't have a bulletin, get one when you leave. If you're a member of this church, or if you're a member of another church, you just substitute your church's name in there this morning. But I'd like for you to make this pledge today. I'm going to read it aloud, and you can say it with me if you'd like, or if not, you can say it under your breath, or you can think it, or you don't have to say it at all. If you don't want to say it, don't say it at all. But this is what I want to be, and this is what I want you to be, because when we're like this, we're going to be unified. Jesus is going to work through us and in us, and people are going to see us, and they're going to know that we love one another. This is how it goes. You can say it with me if you'd like. I pledge to be a source of unity at KMBC. I know there are no perfect church leaders or members, but neither am I. I will not be a source of gossip. I will do all within my power to unify our church for the sake of the gospel.